Well, hello and welcome to our our last Zoom session for 125 Hearing Disorders. Today is July 15, 2019. Now, normally, we still have another Zoom session on pseudohypoacusis, which is faking hearing loss. Okay, normally we do. However, I'm told that final exams are starting the week of the 19th, which is, this coming Friday. So I don't quite understand that. If I do hold another Zoom session on pseudohypoacusis, I will be the first to let you know, okay? But for now, let's just make it an assumption that this is our last one, and it is on retrocochlear pathology, continuing from where we left off last week. So without any further ado, let's share screen and look at our notes regarding retrocochlear pathology. I'll make this just a little bit bigger. All right, a little larger. Oh, yeah, that's big. Okay, have a look. Last week, we covered a lot of ground. And so what we'll do today is kind of review a little bit of what we did last week, and then we'll complete this particular unit today. So retrocochlear pathology means pathology of the eighth nerve or brain stem or anywhere beyond the cochlea. And remember your terms of central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. Be sure to know what the differences are. Central nervous system is the brain and the spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system is everything else. So is the eighth nerve part of the central nervous system? No, because it's not the brain stem or the spinal cord. Even though it's in the skull, it's not part of the central nervous system. Note these four terms and have a handle on these four. They are gray areas and white areas. And you'll remember from anatomy class, the white areas is the fat myelin sheath that lines the neuron fiber. And the neuron cell body is gray, and it's not myelinated with a fatty sheath. The fatty myelin sheath is white, and it covers usually the arms of the neuron fiber. The cell body, or nucleus, is gray. So in the central nervous system, you have tracts and nuclei. Gray matter or white matter in the central nervous system. In the peripheral nervous system, you have nerves and ganglia. Again, white matter and gray matter, respectively, in the peripheral nervous system. The next section be sure to have down regarding this unit is eighth nerve is a sensory nerve, and sensory nerves are afferent. They take info from the outside and take it to the brain. And all brain-going information is essentially sensory. Your senses, touch, feel, hear, seeing, smelling, all that stuff. Knowledge of where your limbs are in space, all of that is brain-going. And the eighth nerve is therefore a sensory nerve, and sensory nerves are bipolar. It means they have a cell body and two arms. Motor neurons are efferent. They go from the central nervous system, the brain and spinal cord, and they radiate out to the muscles and to your glands. And those are efferent nerves. And efferent nerves are outgoing from the brain, and they control muscles and glands, and they are called motor neurons, and they are multipolar. They will have a cell body and many different arms. Okay, so hold those distinctions close, because that's kind of like a review almost of anatomy that you had last semester. Retrocochlear pathology, the main sign. Remember, signs are seen and symptoms are reported. The main sign of retrocochlear pathology usually is an eighth nerve tumor, and an eighth nerve tumor occurs on one eighth nerve, almost never both. And know what the rate is. Have this down. About 1 in 100,000. So it's not very common, and yet it can kill you. Eighth nerve tumors are benign. They usually can be taken out. what's the difference between benign and malignant? Well, malignant means you can't really get it out with surgery. It's like a web, okay? Benign means it's kind of shaped like something you can get it out. Excuse me. Audiologists see very few acoustic neuromas or eighth nerve tumors, but once they're seen, you're sent immediately to a physician to get them removed, okay? Because it will kill you. Schuppnacht. He said, this is the guy that coined the various types of presbycusis that we covered a couple of weeks ago. Schuppnacht says eighth nerve tumors are comprise about 8 to 10% of all intracranial tumors. Okay, intra means within, cranium means the skull of all brain tumors. The initial symptom is usually tinnitus or hearing loss on one side. That's why unilateral sensory neural loss is a red flag for retrocochlear pathology, because it usually hits one eighth nerve, never both. So that's where a case history comes into account. You need to know, was the noise more on one side? So the guy has sensory neural loss on one ear due to excessive noise to that ear. Got to have a case history. So, or does the person have Meniere's disease, which usually is unilateral, okay? Then that's going to be another cause of unilateral sensory neural loss. But in absence of any other explanation, unilateral sensory neural loss is a red flag, and you need to send to a physician to refer or to an audiologist to make sure or rule out an eighth nerve tumor. Know what the sizes are. They're not very big, okay? Less than a centimeter to more than 2 centimeters in size. They grow at the rate of about a centimeter a year. And here's a place to put a star by. Tumor size has an effect on of how good the test will be at picking it out. It's harder to find a small eighth nerve tumor than it is a large one. That's only common sense. And retrocochlear pathology, it says in the last two lines here, is relatively hard to detect. It's therefore the testing ground for many tests. And that's why last week we reviewed this section as well. And we looked at various terms regarding tests. This is the ground where tests are tested. You've got about 6 different words here. And then you got a couple more on the others on the top of page 2. So have a look here. Validity, reliability. Have those memorized. Validity is how good is the test at testing what it's testing. Or I shouldn't say how good it is, just is the test testing what it says it's testing? Does the test say it's looking for an eighth nerve tumor, but actually it's not really testing that? Now you might think, well, that's kind of weird, but let me just kind of take you to the end of today's talk, just to give you a preview. There's one type of retrocochlear pathology is, and I'll stop sharing for a second, we'll just look at you. One type of retrocochlear pathology is learning disabilities. A child with nothing wrong with his ears, nothing wrong with his eighth nerves, nothing wrong with his brain stem, but problems in the brain when it comes to listening. A kid can hear, but he's just not listening, okay? ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. ADD, attention deficit disorder. Okay, all of these terms, LD, learning disabilities, all dyslexia, all these terms that refer more to brain things. Now, there's a test that audiologists are taught to do to look at children who are having difficulty listening in the classroom. It's almost like the sentence he can see, he's just not looking. He can hear, he's just not listening. Okay, it's the attention you're focusing. Well, one of these tests is called dichotic digits. And what's done with that test is you have a set of headphones on the ear, and 2 digits are played here, and 2 numbers are played here. And the numbers are any number between 1 and 10, except 7, because 7 has 2 syllables. But 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10 each have 1 syllable. These are randomly it's presented in pairs. 6, 8, 1, 9, like variant. So you have four numbers. Maybe, for example, 6 and 8 might be put here. 1 and 9 might be put here. And they're put in dichotically. Like, so your ears are getting different different sounds at the same time. Remember the term dichotic from acoustics? Simultaneous but different sounds to both ears. Remember I told you in acoustics class, you're trying to guide your cousin into town because he stopped at the edge of town and doesn't know where your house is. So you're on the phone saying, well, when you get to the stoplight, turn right. And your wife is going, no, that's the wrong way. It's very irritating. Remember that? Okay. Different sounds to each ear at the same time. It's unnatural. It's like having two telephones and two different conversations. Okay. So it's really testing the link. So dichotic digits. And the assumption is left ear info goes to the right temporal lobe. Left ear info goes to the right, or right ear information digits or whatever, go to the left temporal lobe. Because the assumption in dichotic digits is, remember we talked about pathways going up to the brain and they crisscross, decussation, crisscross, okay? Decussation, well, during dichotic listening only, and only during dichotic listening, the ipsilateral pathways are suppressed and contralateral pathways win. Okay, during dichotic listening, and only during dichotic listening, ipsilateral pathways up to the brain are suppressed and the contras win. And it is said that the left temporal lobe is dominant for speech. That's the other assumption. Okay, the left temporal lobe is more dominant than the right temporal lobe for speech. So the two assumptions, during dichotic listening, the contralateral pathways win. And the second assumption, the left temporal lobe is dominant for speech. Okay, so which ear is going to win during dichotic listening? The right, because it's going to the it's going to the dominant hemisphere. The left is going to the non-dominant hemisphere, plus it would have to cross the corpus callosum, that white matter bridge that links the halves of your brain, remember that? So the left ear goes to the non-dominant hemisphere, and then it has to cross the corpus callosum to get to the left. So the left ear has a longer pathway, the right ear wins. So most of the digits presented to the right ear are remembered. And the kid usually doesn't remember quite as many of the digits that were presented to the left ear. Okay, so four digits are presented, two to each ear simultaneously, and they are randomly, and they're just, and the child usually has a right ear advantage. It is said that when you grow up, the right ear advantage essentially gets minimized. It might be like 52% compared to 48%, okay? In other words, it'll have a slight advantage, but not much. And the assumption is that when children have learning disabilities, their corpus callosum isn't done yet. And because it's not myelinated or finished yet, they'll have a big right ear advantage, because the left ear goes to the non-dominant hemisphere and hardly can cross over and get to the left. Now, back to our conversation about validity. Is the dichotic digits test really testing what it says it's testing? Is it really testing for learning disabilities? Or is it just testing for how myelinated the corpus callosum is? Like, what is it really testing? Okay, and little girls mature quicker than boys as far as the corpus callosum goes, and little girls learn language quicker than boys. So in a weird way, maybe the dichotic digits test is more of a test of gender than it is of learning disabilities. Do you see what I'm saying? So validity of a test, does it test what it says it's testing? Reliability is the next one on that list. And let's look at reliability. That simply means how good is the test at being consistent? Will the test show the same results on the same person again and again? It's more of a stability issue. So those two terms are often used together when talking about tests. And then we had four more things that you might remember from acoustics class, from psychoacoustics, and they were true positives, true negatives, false positives, and false negatives. And that's where we got to our little boxes from hell. And we went way down over here, and we talked about hearing tones. Remember from acoustics? And we're reviewing this because it's important conceptually to understand this, okay? If you're hearing the tones always at 50, you got normal hearing, the tones are always at 50. Well, that's easy peasy Japanesey, because every time you hear a 50 dB tone, you're going to say, yep. And every time you don't hear a 50 dB tone, you're going to say, nope. So you're going to have true positives, true negatives. But if the tone is 5 dB, the task is harder. Now you're going to have true positives and true negatives, but you'll also have false positives, raising a hand when the tone wasn't there, or false negatives. Maybe you'll keep your hand down when actually the time before you did hear it. Okay? So those are the mistakes. And that same analogy can be held with testing. Okay? Did the test catch the disease? This is the same. It's analogous to when you heard the tone, did you say yes? Okay? If you had a tumor, did the test catch you? If the test is very sensitive, it's going to say if the disease is present, it's going to catch you. Okay? It's a true positive or a hit. And if a disease is absent, okay, will the test pass you and say you don't have the disease? Now, almost no test is 100% sensitive and 100% specific. What's sensitivity? The ability of a test to catch you when you've got the disease. But you can have a really sensitive test that catches everyone who's got the disease, but it also caught a few people that didn't have the disease. It was overly sensitive. On the other hand, so that test is going to have a lot of true positives. It's going to catch a lot of people that have the disease. But in some people that don't have the disease, it's going to say you've got the disease. And that's going to be a drag for the person because he's got to drive to another city to get to another, to do another test to find out, is it really true? Okay, so that will be a mistake. A test may be really sensitive. It'll catch everyone that's got it, but it might falsely identify some people that don't have it. On the other hand, a test might be really specific. And a specific test is that it passes everyone that doesn't have the disease. It's true negatives or correct rejection. In other words, you don't have the disease, and the test said, nope, you don't have the disease. That test may pass everyone that doesn't have the disease, but it might end up passing a few people that do have the disease. In other words, it might have some false negatives. So a test that's very specific is a test that passes everyone that doesn't have the disease, but it might end up passing a few people that have a small tumor. And this is where we get into our identifications. Okay? Validity, reliability, sensitivity, specificity. And then I get into all these weird things. I wouldn't worry so much, but you can kind of look at this. We'll just kind of look at this. Here. Here's test score. 0 to 100, let's say. And here's the probability of getting a test score. Let's say you got a whole bunch of people that have a disease. That's the solid bell curve. And some people who have the disease might get this score. Some people who have the disease might get this score. Some people who have the disease might get this score. And then you've got another distribution of people. They don't have the disease. But look at all the overlap. So this is not a very good test. There's lots of error, lots of overlap. All this area here is overlap. The middle test is better. The people who have the disease, are their test scores are all over here. Okay. The people that don't have the disease, their test scores fall over here. There's just a little bit of overlap. The bottom test is the best one. There's no overlap. That's a gold standard. Okay. The people who have the disease are all caught, and the people that don't have the disease are all passed. There's no intersection of the distributions of people. There's no error. Okay, so basically this slide is explaining everything that we talked about. Sensitivity, ability of a test to catch someone who's got it. Specificity, ability of a test to pass someone who doesn't have it. Most tests are not 100% sensitive. They're not 100% specific. A gold standard one really is. So we'll go now to our notes and just look at our notes, because now we launch on into the different types of tests. So here's the same thing as we've talked about, so we no need to repeat that. But the bottom line is, that's why in all medicine, whether it's nursing, chiropractic, optometry, our field, you always use a battery of tests. No test stands alone. And by example, pure tone testing, speech testing, tympanometry. Stop sharing for a second. What are the three main audiometric tests that we do in our field? Headphones, raise your hand when you hear a tone. Take off the headphone, bone oscillator behind the ear, raise your hand when you hear the tones. Okay? The differences between the way you heard through air versus through bone tell you whether you had a conductive or a sensory neural loss. Great. So pure tone testing tells you the degree of loss and the type of loss. The second part of the test is speech testing. Speech reception threshold testing, most comfortable loudness level testing, speech recognition testing, or word recognition, or speech discrimination, and uncomfortable loudness level. And then you have the third test, and it's tympanometry, the type of tympanogram that you have. And physical volume is in there, and static compliance, the height of your tympanogram, and acoustic reflexes are in there. So you can see the pieces of a hearing test. Just like a stool needs three legs to stand. Okay? No test by itself is perfect. You need to buttress it up with other tests, and that's called a test battery. So in a way, this hearing disorders course has fingers into audiometry, has fingers into anatomy. It even has fingers into acoustics. And that's why all those three courses are prerequisites for this one. Okay, it ties things in. All right, share screen again, and let's look at some of the different types of tests that are used. When we try and scroll down here, for retrocochlear pathology, the best tests are non-behavioral. No voluntary response. You didn't have to raise your hand. The test picked out what your body was doing automatically. Radiologic tests like MRIs are the best, especially the ones that use a dye to enhance the gold, the gray and the white matter better. CT scans are kind of like a blurry MRI. MRI means magnetic resonance imaging. CT scans means computerized tomography. Computerized tomography, T-O-M-O-graphy. Okay? Magnetic resonance imaging is mo beta. Anyway, those are the best. Okay? They are the most sensitive and the most specific. MRI with the dye is the almost a gold standard. It can detect tumors less than a centimeter easily. The hit rates, in other words, the true positives and true negatives, are almost 99%. ABR is done by audiologists, not by doctors. Audiologists do ABR. Sometimes technicians trained in the hospital do them, but they don't know how to interpret them. Okay? ABR has a correct hit rate or true positive of about 95% and a true negative of about 89%. Then below, you're getting into behavioral. Word recognition, tone decay, not very good. Acoustic reflex and acoustic reflex decay are better than tone decay, and they're better than word recognition. They are better because they're non-behavioral. But still, they're not as good as ABR. So I guess the rate would go, MRI is the best, CAT scan is next, ABR is next, and then acoustic reflex and acoustic reflex decay would be next. And then below that, behavioral tests. Word recognition, correct, you know, tone decay. And we described a little bit about those before. And we'll just kind of review that quickly today, okay? We'll look at some of those behavioral ones. Stop sharing. The behavioral ones, you're listening to single syllable words at a most comfortable loudness. In the good ear that doesn't have a tumor, and in the other ear that has the eighth nerve tumor. And you're putting the words in at a comfortable loudness, MCL, most comfortable loudness. And the words are said like, say the word cat. Say the word tree. Say the word now. You can't see the face. Okay, you're just saying the words out of context. The words aren't getting softer. They're staying the same. Now you're in the bad ear. It may have only about a 30 decibel hearing loss. Not much, just a noticeable difference. So it's a unilateral sensory neural loss. And you find out the most comfortable loudness level for that ear, which isn't usually that much more than to the good ear, maybe a little bit. And you're saying kind of the words like that again. Say the word cup. Say the word clock. And the person can hardly repeat them back. Terrible word recognition. So you make the words louder to the bad ear, and the word recognition actually gets worse. And you make the words louder, and it gets worse. That's called rollover. And rollover is an old test, and I'll show you a picture of it in the PowerPoints. Let's look at rollover. Fat and skinny went to bed. Fat rolled over and skinny was dead. Okay, let's see if we've got a rollover test here to look at. I'm not sure we do. Let's see if we do or not. No, yeah, here it is. Good. All right, and blow that up. Now, performance intensity function. What was the intensity? Pretend this is DBHL. Pretend it's just DB. And this is your percents. A normal hearing person will do probably really good at around 100% when the words are about 50 dB, 40 plus, and the guy's doing, yep, pretty good. He'll get all the words. If you have hair cell damage, you might be at the next curve. You'll never really get 100% because you got some hair cell damage, but you'll do pretty good. And then you look at eighth nerve tumor and you can see the rollover, where actually your performance got worse as the intensity got increased. So this is an old-fashioned, ancient test, no longer used really that much because we've got better ones that are non-behavioral today. But you need to know your history, otherwise you were condemned to repeat it. That's what a philosopher once said. So let's follow that same advice and make sure that we know what rollover is. Word recognition or speech discrimination actually gets worse as the words are presented louder. And that is because the eighth nerve has a tumor in it and it's overloaded. It's like a rock in the middle of a stream and the stream has to go around that rock. You've overloaded the eighth nerve, okay? And so one of the signs of that would have been rollover. Another ancient test, we'll stop sharing for a second, was tone decay. and you presented a loud tone, maybe 1,000 hertz, at around 100 dB to the bad ear, and you had the guy keep his hand up the whole time he heard the tone. It was said that if you had an eighth nerve tumor and you presented the tone loudly for about a minute, the guy might put his hand down after 30 seconds because the eighth nerve once again got overloaded. And they called that tone decay. Well, how valid of a test is that? And how reliable of a test is that? And how sensitive and how specific is a test like that? Not very, because you might have a lot of people wanting to put their hand down because the tone was irksome. It bothered them, annoying. Maybe the person thought you're going to make him deaf, so he put his hand down. See what I'm saying? So behavioral tests aren't as good. Acoustic reflex was better because it's your muscles are tightening. You have no control over that. A loud tone is put into the good ear. And you're seeing the afferent pathways, which is the outer ear, middle ear, inner hair cells, eighth nerve, brainstem, and then muscles pulling on the tensor tympani and the stapedius muscle. Okay, so you're testing the whole arc. Well, if you've got a tumor, the eighth nerve is part of the acoustic reflex arc. And if the acoustic reflex arc is interrupted by a tumor, you'll have absent acoustic reflexes. That's not bad. That's better than tone decay. But it's not quite as good as ABR. And that's where we went last week and talked a little bit about ABR, which was kind of cool. And let's look at ABR for a second. Okay, before we do that, here's acoustic reflex decay. Okay, loud tone, and how long do they present that? Because this is a wrinkle on the acoustic reflex test. You may have absent acoustic reflexes, but then again, maybe not. So the audiologist looks a little further. And I say the audiologist, not the HIS, because the HIS doesn't do acoustic reflex decay. Audiologists are taught to do it. So maybe the person has acoustic reflex, but the audiologist also still suspects eighth nerve tumor. So the audiologist will present a loud tone to the bad ear, and here's the acoustic reflex kicking in. And it hangs on for the whole length of that 10-second tone. The tone is presented for only 10 seconds. You can see that down at the bottom. 10 seconds. Okay, so this is a normal acoustic reflex, hanging in there for the duration of the tone. Here's acoustic reflex decay. And here's really acoustic reflex decay. All right, so it's just like doing chin-ups on a bar. How long could you hold on before you just couldn't hold on anymore? So they're looking at the decay of the acoustic reflex. And if it decays by more than 50%, over 5 seconds, you've got acoustic reflex decay. And that is a positive, meaning a bad sign, for an eighth nerve tumor. Here's an ABR that we described last week. Okay, the ABR. And the ABR, I said last week, and we'll talk and remember just sort of a refresher. An electrode is taped here. An electrode is taped here. And the wires are plugged into the computer. Another electrode is taped here, right between the eyes. That's a ground. And another electrode is taped right at the hairline at the top of your forehead. And then headphones are put on your ears. And one ear at a time. First the right ear, then the left ear. These weird little tones called clicks are put into the ears. And clicks, what are they? Here's a click. See how short that wave is? It's just it's like a little spike, and it literally is like a click. And those are put in really rapidly. And the clicks are not very frequency specific. Look at the spectrum. Look at how broad it is. So the click, even though here's the waveform of the click, here's its spectrum. So clicks are not very frequency specific, so it's hard to tell what frequencies the child may hear. But the first reason for doing the ABR is to test hearing in a baby or in a child who won't answer normally. or in someone who's lying, a malingerer. Now, pseudohypocusis, faked hearing loss, okay, would be the last particular unit of this course. I'm not sure whether I'll hold a Zoom session, but I'll let you know, okay? All right, but the ABR is a test done for people with pseudohypocusis who are faking hearing loss for financial reasons or for psychological reasons. God only knows, but they're faking it. Maybe they want money from the government. Maybe they're not getting enough attention, whatever. So you put the clicks into the right ear, and you later on you do the left ear. And what you find at the end of it only takes a couple of minutes. You get 5 bumps appearing on your screen. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and a few more afterwards, but we don't care. Then the tones are made, the clicks are made softer and softer and softer. And each time you make them softer, the waves get smaller and they get more delayed. Finally, the only wave left is peak 5. But if you can still see a peak 5 and you're down at 20 dB, you know the right ear is pretty normal. Then the left ear, same thing. Okay, so this would be one application of the ABR, auditory brainstem response. The other application of this same test is for retrocochlear pathology. All right, right ear has no problem. Once again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you're at 80 dB. Make it 60. The waves get smaller and more delayed. Make it 30, the waves get smaller and only peak 5 appears. And it's kind of like a progression like this. This one they reduce by 10 to 70 to 60 to 50 to 40 to 30 and so on until you didn't see anything anymore. That's the application for hearing testing. But even if the person you can see waves all the way down to 20, what frequency is it that the person hears all the way down to 20? Because remember, the click has a broad frequency response, so you don't know if it's these frequencies that the guy hears, or these, or these, or these. You're not sure. The click is not very frequency specific. Okay? That's why audiologists they can't use the ABR only to test for the baby's hearing levels. It's a good indication, but they don't really know always what frequencies the baby's hearing that's normal. You can just say that the baby's hearing some frequencies normally. Okay? See how tests kind of work? They don't all stand by themselves. Anyway, using the ABR to look at an eighth nerve tumor. Let's say the left ear's got a tumor. Look, when you're presenting it at 90, the waves are spread out compared to the right ear. But maybe the hearing loss is only tiny. Maybe the eighth nerve tumor is only making about a 30 decibel hearing loss. And yet, even though you jacked up the intensity, the ABR is prolonged. It's stretched out. And where is the guilty party in the prolongation? In other words, what's making 1 to 5 bigger than this 1 to 5. See how tight this 1 to 5 is? Where's the prolongation? It's between peaks 1 and 3. Here they're nice and tight. Here it's big. Whereas the distance between 3 and 5 here is the same as the distance between 3 and 5 here. And why is that significant? Because peak 1 is where the eighth nerve leaves the inner hair cells. Peak 2 is where the eighth nerve hits the brain stem. So peaks 1 and 2 are eighth nerves. 3, 4, and 5 are the brain stem. So the ABR is looking at the eighth nerve and the brain stem. And what part of this left ear ABR is abnormal? The 1 to 3 interval. So you say, you know what? You've got an 8th nerve tumor. If the 3 to 5 were stretched out and the 1 to 3 was normal, you'd say, oh, you've got a brainstem tumor. See what I mean? And look what happened when they made it 80. When they reduced it down to 80, it was gone. And remember, the hearing loss may not be all that much. Okay? This is how the ABR is used to detect retrocochlear pathology. Audiologists are really taught to measure the distances between the peaks. We don't in our field, so don't worry about this slide. This is just for fun. Okay? This is an ABR with peaks 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. That's all. Anyway, if you read with me, you may have seen this before in anatomy. Acoustic neuromas caught our family completely by surprise. Have a read of this. And when you get down to this brainstem auditory evoked response, that's just, they have it bare, B-A-E-R. That's the same as ABR. Okay? But the test was inconclusive. Huh, see that? It wasn't very good. It didn't work. Statistically, 1 in 100,000 people in North America are detected with an acoustic neuroma. They finally did surgery. Okay, let's see. They referred to and they did a CAT scan, and the CAT scan revealed a 3-centimeter tumor growing from her auditory. That means her internal auditory meatus, the tiny tunnel through which the 8th nerve travels. How long is the 8th nerve? An inch. What else about the 8th nerve? It's the shortest of your 12 pairs of cranial nerves. The 8th pair is the shortest. So this is a very good one to read. I would ask you to read it on your own, and it gives you a little bit of an idea as to the problems that can occur with an 8th nerve. And it's meant for the general public to read, so I encourage you to have a read of it yourselves. Here's a PowerPoint slide talking about tests for retrocochlear pathology, speech discrimination, write down behavioral, tone decay, behavioral, acoustic reflex, non-behavioral, ABR, non-behavioral, this, non-behavioral. And then you get to this one, central auditory processing disorders. And that's of children. Learning disabilities. Can hear, just can't listen. So your central auditory nervous system is comprised of your brain stem, central auditory. Okay, not central nervous system, but central auditory nervous system. Brain stem, because you don't have any auditory nervous system stuff in your spinal cord. The only place that, when you're talking regarding hearing, what's the central nervous system part of hearing? It begins in the brain stem, and that is where the 8th nerve meets the brain stem, and that particular nucleus is called the cochlear nucleus. And what's up above in the brain stem, above the cochlear nucleus, the superior olivary complex. And what's above the superior olivary complex pair of nuclei? The lateral lemniscus pair of nuclei. And what's in the high brain stem? The inferior colliculi pair of nuclei. And what's above that? Now you've left the brain stem and you're in the thalamus, which is the grand central station where all the railroad tracks meet, all sensory information, except smell, for some reason, meets at the thalamus. So the thalamus has auditory areas there. And then you radiate out to the sides of your brain, to the temporal lobes of the brain. And what is that nucleus called? Heschel's gyrus. And then you have surrounding associative auditory areas. Broca's area, Wernicke's area, remember all of those? All right. And then what's the white matter link that links the halves of the brain together, the corpus callosum? So 8th nerve hits the brain stem, you have an explosion of types of cells. Interestingly, the spinal cord has gray matter on the inside, white matter on the outside, but the brain is exactly the opposite. You've got some remarkable diversity in types of neurons inside the central nervous system. don't worry about this, but this is just telling you how as you go higher and higher up, you have an explosion of numbers of cells. Front of the brainstem. Here's where the eighth nerve meets the brainstem at the pons and the medulla, the pontomedullary junction. Here's the back of the brainstem. And you can see four bumps here. So back to the front, back to the front, front to the back, back. Medulla, pons, midbrain. So in the at the junction, cochlear nucleus. Higher up, superior olivary complexes, lateral lemniscus, inferior colliculi. Look at the back. Superior colliculi, inferior colliculi. Superior for vision, inferior for audition. It's where visual and auditory information meets. Here's a sagittal view of the brain, medulla, pons, midbrain, thalamus, corpus callosum, cerebellum, which is for fine motor control movement. Here's a real view, medulla, pons, midbrain, thalamus, corpus callosum. And again, medulla, pons, midbrain, thalamus, corpus callosum. And here's a layout of exactly what we've talked about, but more like a schematic. And again, look at the decussation, the crossover. Ipsilateral, contralateral. There are two places where auditory input can cross from side to side. Let's look at this picture closely. Have a peek here. Ear, outer ear, middle ear, eustachian tube going down to your throat, cochlea, eighth nerve, brainstem. Look at the crossover. Going higher up, thalamus. Radiating out to Heschel's gyrus, Heschel's gyrus. So you've got one crossover area taking place at the brain stem, but the other crossover is higher up at the corpus callosum, which links the halves of your brain. Remember, this is a coronal view. It's as if someone sliced you around from one ear to the other ear. Here it's showing you as a schematic. Eighth nerve, crossover, going to the, and there's a mistake in this picture. Please remember, this should be the right hemisphere with the smaller Heschel's gyrus. This should be the left with a larger Heschel's gyrus. Okay, so there's a mistake here. RH is right hemisphere. It should read left hemisphere. Remember we said the left hemisphere is dominant for speech. Heschel's gyrus is larger in most people in the left. In most right-handers especially. Left-handers have a more even distribution, by the way. It's not opposite of right-handers, but it's more even. Anyway, how you'd have to pull apart this fissure. See this fissure here? Well, someone's pulling it apart in order to reveal Heschel's gyrus inside. And again, showing you from the side how you'd have to pull it apart. This circle here essentially is showing you Heschel's gyrus. Okay? You have to pull the brain apart. This is showing you a coronal view. This is showing you a side view. Central auditory processing disorder. Look at this. We're going to end exactly where we began. Also called learning disabilities, attention deficit disorders, attention deficit hyperactivity disorders. Nothing wrong with the ears. The kid just can't listen. Behaviors of some of these children. I'll let you read this. Have a read for yourself. What's with central auditory processing disorders? And what's with the dichotic digits? And what's with those boys? So circle CAPD, central auditory processing disorders. It's not a tumor. There's nothing really wrong that they can see. in the brain. The brain looks pretty normal. The only abnormal thing might be that the corpus callosum isn't finished yet in these kids. So here's a picture of the dichotic digits test. It's a behavioral test. That's also why it's not very good. It's behavioral, okay? Nonetheless, here's a pairs of numbers between 0 and 10. It should be between 1 and 10, except 7, because of the two syllables, are presented simultaneously to both ears. In this case, 1 and 9 were to the left ear, and 6 and 4 were to the right ear. And which numbers was the kid able to remember? Which ones was he able to repeat back to you? And you ask the child, doesn't matter, you don't have to tell me the order, nothing. Just repeat the digits that you heard to both ears. So what were they? And the child will usually end up having a right ear advantage, largely because of this slide here, because of the corpus callosum. Largely because of this. This is showing you here, it's a bunch of repetition in this particular PowerPoint, don't worry about it. Here it is, the two assumptions of dichotic listening. The one assumption is the left temporal lobe is dominant for language. That's why I drew it in blue. And I even made the gray area thicker here than the gray area over here. Okay? During dichotic listening, the contralateral pathways suppress the ipsilateral pathways. So the one assumption is the left temporal lobe is dominant for language. The second assumption is during dichotic listening, and only during dichotic listening, the crossover pathways are stronger than the ipsies. That's why I made the ipsies little dots. So the contralateral pathways win over the ipsilateral pathways. So the digits that are presented to the right ear tend to reach the dominant left hemisphere better than the digits that are presented to the left ear, because those go to the non-dominant right hemisphere and have to cross the corpus callosum to get to the dominant left hemisphere. And so the child will have a right ear advantage. Dichotic digits test, normal findings, a slight right ear advantage. In children with central auditory processing disorders, strong right ear advantage, largely because of that corpus callosum. How did they find this out? Years ago in Montreal, Quebec, Canada, they did studies on people that were having seizures. And in some of these people, they did what's called a commissurotomy. A commissurotomy means they went into the brain and they severed the corpus callosum. They broke the corpus callosum in half, sewed the person back up again. And in some cases, the seizures really went down. But when they tried to do dichotic digits, they were experimenting, those people had a huge right ear advantage in black, big time. Why? Because the corpus callosum was severed. And this is how they found out that the corpus callosum had something to do in dichotic listening. But again, is dichotic listening really a test of learning disabilities in children? I'm of two minds about it. It might indicate a delayed corpus callosum function, which might have some indication about listening in a classroom. I don't know, but all I know is labels stick. And it's hard to peel off labels. Boys and girls are wired differently. They're different. The boys have different hormones running through them. Maybe they do learn later. There's different norms for learning English. Did you know that? Little girls learn to talk before little boys. On average, girls are better than boys are at learning languages, children. Okay. Boys catch up later, but girls are usually ahead first for the first year or two. Okay. In some boys, they take a long time for that corpus callosum to mature. But does it mean that they're stupid? Not really. A lot of learning disabled people have higher than average intelligence. So there's a lot, it's nothing to do with IQ. I just think people should think a little differently about it. When you're teaching little girls, they often know how to color within the lines. They know how to behave. They know what Mrs. Smith wants in the classroom. Sometimes the little boys are bouncing off the walls. The teacher shouldn't freak. The best thing to do is to increase the signal-to-noise ratio. Put tennis balls on the bottoms of the chairs so they don't scrape the ground as much. Hang a carpet in the back of the classroom so you don't get as much reverberation. Have the teacher wear a cheap mic with cheap speakers in the room that make her or his voice a little bit louder than the background noise. You'll increase the audibility of the teacher's voice better. The kids will listen better. Okay, so these are the kinds of things that, you know, when you label someone with learning disabilities, it's really hard to unpeel that label. And oftentimes, the kid gets a poor self-awareness of it. He gets a poor, self-image, ends up hanging with the wrong crowd, ends up going to juvenile detention center, ends up in jail, until maybe a judge sends the kid to the army, where he gets 3 good square meals a day and behaves himself and loves the routine. And as I've said in other courses, learns to become about the best helicopter pilot around. So yeah, these are the things, you know. So let's share screen to end our notes here, because this is what we've covered. And look at our notes. Here we are. Rolled on down. By the way, otoacoustic emissions are lousy at detecting retrocochlear pathology. Okay, so just don't even think about them. We looked at acoustic reflex a little bit, acoustic reflex decay. We looked at ABR. The 2 reasons for doing ABR would be listed right here. Okay, so put a star by that. Don't worry about knowing what a click stimuli, just know that it doesn't have good frequency specificity. It's measured by putting electrodes on the head. It's behavioral. You usually will see 5 peaks. The shape should be normal. The peaks should appear at proper times. You don't have to know what the times are because the HIS doesn't do it. But you should know what the ABR is and what it's for. And then we got into the dichotic digits test for central auditory testing, and that's mainly for learning disabilities in children. Children who can hear, their hearing thresholds are normal, but they just can't listen. And there's where we went over all the stuff here in our notes is exactly what we covered in the PowerPoint. So essentially, my fine feathered friends, we have covered the disorders of the ear from outer to middle to inner to 8th nerve and then even to the brain. Okay? You don't get that many tumors of Heschel's gyrus. You don't get that many tumors of the thalamus. You usually will have 8th nerve tumors, or if you have a brain tumor, it might occur anywhere in the brain. But the other, so you're really looking at 8th nerve pathology, which is an 8th nerve tumor, or learning disabilities in the classroom, which is central, and the tests are usually behavioral. Okay. So we've covered lots of ground in this field. We don't do the ABR as HISs. We don't do the dichotic digits test as HISs. We stick to fitting adults with hearing aids. So we do pure tone testing by air conduction and bone conduction. We do speech testing, most comfortable loudness, speech reception threshold, speech discrimination, uncomfortable loudness level, and we do tympanometry. Type of tympanogram, static compliance, the height of the tympanogram, physical volume of air in the canal, is the eardrum punctured? Are you measuring the volume of air in the canal as well as the air in your middle ear space because of the hole in the eardrum? And acoustic reflex testing. So all that's part of tympanometry. So audiometry that we do as HISs is confined to what I was showing you here. Audiologists who get the AUD degree from Missouri State University, two blocks or three blocks away from OTC in Springfield, Missouri, okay, they end up going for the AUD, and they learn how to do the ABR, and they learn how to do all kinds of behavioral tests for central auditory processing disorders. They also learn how to fit adults with hearing aids, but they've also got to do ABRs on babies, infants. So you can see how our fields are connected, how they intersect, okay, but they are a bit different. Yet many, many audiologists focus on fitting adults with hearing aids, because that's where the money is. Anyway, it's been a slice. Talk to you later. See you when I look at you. I'll stop recording now, and I'll send an email to each and every one of you letting you know whether yay or nay I will do another Zoom session to end this course on pseudohypoacusis or not. Okay, I'll talk with Lynn Royer specifically about that and get back to you. Adios, amigos. Live long and prosper.